Please note, everyone, I've started the recording for this as well. I saw a comment in the chat. This discussion will be recorded and also form part of the public record for the event. So I'll repeat that in a minute, but just so folks are aware.
And Mary, you're going to sort of help me coordinate sort of the information on this Jamboard.
Yes, Andrew.
Perfect. Okay. And I'll help as well.
And while we're waiting for folks to join, welcome Sarah and Clara as well.
Hi.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hi. Hello.
Hello there.
All right, well, I guess we could go ahead and get started. And so, I was already introduced, but just to sort of give you one or two more things. So my area is mainly international trade and agricultural trade and policy affecting agricultural trade. So I often think about issues of markets as it relates to information flows. But man, I'm real excited to be facilitating this discussion. And one of the things we would like is as much feedback as possible in terms of how you think about markets in ways in which sort of governments, businesses, and other entities can intervene in markets to improve the livelihood of smallholder producers in developing countries, as well as just to sort of think about overall efficiencies in markets, such that obviously we reduce things like food waste, improve efficiency and production. And so so that's just sort of to help frame things. But at this time, I'd like to introduce my co-facilitator, Mary Biggs. And if you wanted to say a few words, Mary, just in terms of what you'd like to see out of this, as well as just some logistical things so that the group can understand exactly how they could participate.
Wonderful. First, greeting to everybody. It's so great to see such excellent turnout. I think it underscores the importance of this issue in terms of all of the work that we're doing. So thanks so much for your time on this busy day. For the breakout group, there'll be several ways to participate. There's both giving comments directly, in response to ongoing conversation. And we'll also be sharing the link to a Jamboard, which I think many of you have probably used over these past 2 years, but you'll go in and there's sticky notes and you can add your comments in there too. We'll share the link. I would ask though, please also add your name and affiliation along with your comments and suggestions. And those will be in three different areas. As Sophia mentioned, as well as the study team, we're really looking for the points of, where we can see potential for facilitating change within the wider systems, as well as leverage points within those systems in terms of where action may be able to achieve transformative change with climate change adaptation or mitigation, as well as specific intervention ideas. So our Jamboard area is broken into climate finance, leverage points, as well as if people have references or other documents you want to refer, please stick them in there or in the chat and I'll move them over because we can also go back to those and those will also form part of the public record of this event today. And this will be recorded, as I mentioned, and the name and affiliation will also be part of the public record. So please, we encourage vibrant discussion and debate. Andrew, back over to you. And thanks, Andrew. It's such an honor working with you.
Oh man, likewise, and now I'm even more excited. I see a former colleague of two with the U.S. Department of Agriculture on with me, as well as even a student mentee. And so thanks to all of you for joining the breakout room. So why don't we get started? Let's first think about some major areas for just transformative systemic change. All right, let's just sort of think about that. I don't want to dominate the discussion, but and then obviously being a professor now, I have no problem calling on individuals if that's needed. But I do want to start with something that's at least I found to be sort of particularly transformative, and that's the means by which we could translate price signals to smallholder producers and in the use of digital technologies and cell phone technologies to make linkages in terms of price informational linkages along the supply chain, the smallholder producers, such that sort of they make efficient use of markets in terms of maximizing the value of sales. And so I don't know where I would, I guess I would sort of, let's see if I could sort of do this by example here, because I do recall. So Mary, if I recall the practice, all I needed to do was just sort of click one of the sticky notes, but
double click.
All right. And let's see. Now it's still trying to put me in full screen mode or exit full screen mode when I double click or do it. Or is there something on the side? Because I guess I am the example here. Let's see. Let's click this.
Is everyone able to access the, please go through the link in order to access the live Jamboard session and then to double click on that.
All right, so I would go to, got it, perfect. Now I see. All right, I was actually drawing. So here we go. Let's double click.
I can also transfer comments over for people. And people are also free just to give comments, Andrew, in the conversation as well. And we can capture them both through the recording.
All right, so so let's see this as a test. There we go. All right, that was pretty simple and straightforward. And so for those of you comfortable with the technology, the only thing you need to do, just click the link in the chat. It'd be also good if you could sort of say a few things as well and just sort of name, affiliation, and just something quickly typed in for us to keep record. And so so by just a show of hands, is anyone having sort of trouble with the link and accessing the Jamboard? All right, so no one's, all right, well, good. Let's see. All right, so there's some.
And Andrew, you're also open to people raising their hands and giving comments or, you know, spoken comments as well.
All right. So for those of you, if you just want to sort of chime in, even without sort of it going to the Jamboard link. All right, good. So particularly those of you on mobile devices. So Ola BC, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I was just saying, I'm going to try and reconnect from PC so I can use the Jamboard. I mean, it's, my mobile device doesn't seem to be managing well.
If you just want to sort of provide your comment, that's perfectly fine. It's so it's not, I mean, we have a means by which, since we're recording in particular, but as well as, and we could type it in, and I have a separate side note sheet that I'm working on as well.
Great, that works for me too.
Okay. All right, thank you.
My hand raise isn't working, so I'm gonna physically raise my hand.
Jump right in. Perfect.
Just like a couple of probably super obvious pieces that are on my desk right now. One that I think the resiliency of markets is extra important in the era we're going into. The normally reasonably resilient global system that we have has been broken in different ways, and the planting seasons for food, for instance, for next year are worrying. So just a sort of pitch to say this particular topic is going to be more and more critical, I think, in the next couple of years. And then the second thought is just around this importance of strategic food reserves in countries, and that we have really good practices of digitizing them and modernizing them. And helping governments figure out how to do that is I think one of the huge levers that we could be, and that's happening in some countries, less so in others.
Yeah. Thank you. Any other comments from the group?
If I may jump in, forgive me. As a complement to that, I mean, the governments alone may not be able to store enough food for dealing with a climate emergency. So we might also consider what incentives and policies can encourage the private sector actors, you know, the people who regularly go to the farms to collect and aggregate product to manage and improve that process. And if we can reduce loss by these actors, that and these private sector actors that aggregate grain, I think that could complement efforts to support and modernize the government's reserves for making sure food is available in times of crisis.
Thank you. Diane?
And I just wanted to add something, just to mention something.
Hold up, but Tom, one quick second, because Diane had her hand raised, and then I'll go to you right after, okay?
Great, great.
And then we'll go to, so Diane, Tom, and then Deborah.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me?
Oh, we hear you just fine.
Great. I'm Diane Russell. I'm an advisor to the Bureau for Resilience and Food Security, Natural Resource Management Advisor. And I've worked on market systems and tropical agriculture for 3 decades. I work in very poor communities in Central Africa, mostly Democratic Republic of Congo, where shifting cultivation is the major agricultural system, where markets are very poor. You know, and I've since I've been part of RFS, I've heard a lot about sustainable intensification and the role it will play in reducing climate stress, because you can produce more on one area. And I think about my area in DRC with its weak markets and how sustainable intensification would work under those circumstances, where you could produce more food in one area, but all that food would go to people who could afford it, and the poor farmers aren't getting enough revenue to afford sustainable intensification. So I see this market system sort of inextricably linked to this idea of sustainable intensification being a solution to climate change problems. So that's my comment, and I'd love to hear your suggestions. Thank you, over.
Well, thank you. So Tom?
Yeah, thank you very much. And my comment is on the realization that the main challenge with this stomach, okay, let me just introduce myself. My name is Tom. I work for Kickstart International. We work with small, older farmers, supporting them with irrigation solution and across Africa. The main challenge that I've seen is that the climate change extremes, that is when it rains too much, there is flood, and when it doesn't rain, there is drought over a long period of time. So farmers are left on their own. So I think there is a need to shift from the rain-fed farming to irrigated agriculture, which will help farmers to have food secure. So this is some area that I was looking at, if the committee could work on a policy framework that could support low-cost irrigation at the bottom of the pyramid, especially in Africa, that would be a sure way of ensuring there is ready food and nutrition is taken care of. And I think irrigation, there is a lot of water sources in Africa that can be used to do this thing, because of the waste. And a lot of those, like water harvesting, things that could help in a great way to improve food security in Africa. That's my take. Over.
All right, thank you.
Right. Andrew, could I please, Arun and Jules both made comments in the chat. Could we please invite them in? If Arun Zakaria, would you like to add your comment to the conversation, or would you prefer me to read your question? So in case there's a tech issue, Arun says, what are the constraints that may arise when we establish market integrated processing unit, and which may be a potential solution to avoid food waste, wastage and food security? Professor Zakaria is from the College of Agriculture and Affiliated Science in Baramati, India. So looking at some of the bottlenecks around food waste that might contribute to food security, which is a question, if we don't have answers today or others that want to weigh in, we should certainly put that to the study team as well. I know that's an area that they're already identified as a key priority. So great.
And I think one of the things, and I'd love to hear some other comments, and I think that's sort of one of the strategies for sort of using digital technologies, because in a lot of these marketing systems in developing countries, they clearly don't have the resources to provide the information that we provide to in the United States for farmers and producers. And so one of the things I do believe is that sort of linking supply chain participants through these sort of small scale digital technologies could help at least improve the food loss issue as well as the food waste issue. Let's go to Deborah next.
Thanks, Andrew. I have put a comment in the chat. I'm sorry?
I was saying I see Cheryl's hand up. I just want to let her know.
I said I did put a comment in the chat, which I see has been added. And basically, in terms of resilient market systems, I think that we need to spend more time looking at how to support women and youth and other groups for social inclusion in entrepreneurial efforts that actually address climate change. We still tend to put too much emphasis, I think, on engaging women in lower levels of the market chains and production and processing, which may actually be extractive or have other negative repercussions for addressing climate change. And I'd like to see more attention and more money, perhaps from the new gender and climate change budget at AID, to move into support for people with more innovative, broader visions in this area.
Okay. Right, thank you. And so I saw before David, I saw Cheryl's hand up, and then we'll go to you next, and then Jean-Michel after David. So Cheryl Christensen.
Hear me?
We can.
I wanted to talk a little bit.
Can you introduce yourself, if you don't mind?
Sure. I'm Cheryl Christensen. My area of expertise is really international ag development and food security. I spent most of my career at the Economic Research Service at USDA, and I'm now retired in the sense that no one is paying me to do the things that I used to do before, but I'm still doing them anyway. I think the central points on the importance of market integration through better price information and, where possible, digital technologies are really incredible in their importance and their potential impact. And that involves the ability to harness the growing mobile technologies in a lot of African countries. And I don't know the DRC for sure, but I know that in Kenya and Uganda and other East African countries, mobile technologies have penetrated everywhere. And people can use those technologies, and with that information, they can make good local decisions. And so I think as we invest in more market information systems, we need to try to do that in partnership with some of the information platforms and the information links that those platforms entail. One final thing is that for many countries, and Kenya is again a good example, programs to assist people who are in danger as a result of climate activities, the drought is a good example, relief is being delivered also through these mobile systems. And so it gets rid of a lot of the lost time and effort that are involved in some of the more cumbersome physical distributions.
All right. Thank you. So, David.
Okay, thank you, Andrew. Hi, everybody. I'm Dave Shirley with Michigan State University, and I lead the Innovation Lab on Food Security Policy, Research, Capacity, and Influence, PRCI. I had one comment and then a question for Sarah. I don't know if there'll be time for her to address it here, but maybe for later then. The comment, it relates to what Michael was saying about private sector. I also see one of the sticky notes on the missing middle actors. And then it picks up on a question or comment earlier from Sarita Leroux-Potassier about nano, micro, and small scale enterprises, and has to do with, markets are resilient to the extent that actors in those markets are resilient. And, you know, hugely important component of those actors is the whole midstream. So the transporters, the assembly, wholesale, retail traders, processors, storers, you know, other providers of service. So just kind of a plea that when we think about, you know, financing, when we think about information, when we think about technological solutions, that we keep a firm eye on what is not the missing middle, but oftentimes the invisible or hidden middle, because sometimes we don't tend to think about them as much as their importance in the system merits. My question is somewhat related to this for Sarah. It has to do with the digitization of food reserves. Briefly, what is involved in that, and what are some of the countries where you see that has been done successfully? Thanks.
Yeah, I totally agree with your comments on the SMEs and below. Like a great topic for future thinking, so important. So the one that I worked on was in Kenya came to understand that there's a pretty good body of work around literally how do you manage a strategic food reserve at a national level at this point, and it's pretty operational. You know, how do you move around the inventory, how do you fund the capex of it, all of that stuff, what goes in it. There's a lot of questions of exactly what would be needed. Of course, as somebody pointed out, this isn't the only answer, but I think it's a really important piece to make these more efficient. When do they start intervening in markets? Where do they intervene and how? So all of that work has been done on the sort of what are the best practices, and obviously different country by country. But I was surprised at how much work has been done, and I learned a lot. the second part is how do you make it digital? You know, how do you not have pieces of paper flying around or Excel sheets or whatever we're using, that where you don't really know what's in the different parts of your food reserve in the country. And what was created was a balance sheet that was, you know, accessible by all of the politicians, all of the policymakers, so that they knew. And it kind of made decision making more transparent, made decision making easier in some ways. Still not a perfect answer, but there's just, it's just one of those pieces that we know how to do.
No, thank you. And we're going to go to Jean-Michel and Jules next, but just sort of thinking about things in the interest of time. We've already sort of started to actually talk about interventions. And obviously, clearly, if we could just sort of even get through the first one in terms of systemic change in a pretty reasonable way, we've done well for the short time. But let's at least try to pivot towards some leverage points and actual sort of interventions being defined, and particularly as it relates to both positive economic, social, and behavioral change.
I hate to say, it looks like we're closing in 25 seconds.
Oh, wow. So, all right. So Jean-Michel, you got 25 seconds.
Okay. No, I just wanted to emphasize the notion of the forgotten middle, but okay, also the important role of the banks to be involved in trade and working with local banks and help them to access carbon credit systems